Jesse Kove's latest appearance. I know everybody has watched, and we'll talk about it with Jesse, but I'm sure everybody has binged season 3 of Cobra Kai by now. It's amazing. Let's take a look at Jesse's work here.
Piece of junk. Scrap this and buy some muscle. I know, this Notre Dame's turn for a butt kicking next week.
Hey, why'd you run up the score on Stanford? I feel bad for them.
What kind of question is that, Betsy?
They're the opponent.
You don't show them mercy.
Thank you.
What are you looking at, loser?
Sorry. He's the one whose mom killed herself.
Explains why he's such a freak.
Stop that!
Can it, Betsy? A freak is a freak. If you love him so much, start a circus.
Ma'am, pardon the interruption. Just thought the fellas here had the look. We can use you out there in Vietnam, man. It's amazing what you can become with a little discipline and direction. The Army gives a man a true purpose in life. What do you say? This could be you.
Very inspiring. We'll sure think about it.
Ma'am.
Kreese! Tables are not gonna bust themselves. Get back to work.
All right, a little bit of a spoiler there, if you haven't watched already. Let's bring in Jesse Kove. Good morning. Good morning. Jesus, Jesse, it's not morning. It's 7 o'clock where
I am. What do you got in that glass there?
This is my first sip. I literally took the first sip. But I normally do a morning show, and every time I say hi to somebody, it's normally because it's 6 a.m. But here we are, 7 o'clock at night. How are you?
I'm great, man. I just loved watching you show the clip, which we had such a blast shooting. So it's always fun to watch it again.
Well, let's mention right out of the gate that you are the son of the great Martin Kove.
That's correct.
Who plays Kreese in The Karate Kid, Karate Kid 2, and then, of course, Cobra Kai, which has just been a phenomenon. So to see you in that. Now, when you first got on screen, I'm like, hey, kids, look, Kreese. That's Kreese right there, and that's his son. And I'm explaining everything, and I was so sure. And it's a small spoiler. It's okay to give it away right now. But I was so sure that you were playing your dad's character, but you weren't. It was an amazing setup.
They did. They set that up completely. They really wanted the audience to think that I was Kreese for the short period of time. I mean, I even say it. What is it? The diner. They gotta say, don't show them mercy.
Show no mercy. Fantastic. All right. So you were born, what, in 1980? 1990, excuse me. So you missed the 80s. You missed the heyday of
which
the
I love. I want more of the 80s in my life, which is hilarious.
So what is your favorite part of the 80s?
I don't know, man. There's just so much creative energy that happened in the 80s. There was so much that was, you know, that was being put out there. So much, a lot of people took risks, fashion, the movies. You know, some of our favorite movies were made in the 80s. Why? What is it about the 80s?
Well, it was a risk. The fashion was a risk for sure. But Karate Kid came out in 1984. So 1984 alone, and I've always said this, is the quintessential year for the 80s. Karate Kid comes out. You're born in 1990. You have people coming up to you and your dad saying, sweep the leg. And when did you actually grasp the concept that your dad was in this amazing piece of history?
You know, I when I grew up, I would see these posters on my dad's wall all the time, you know, these big Karate Kid posters that he has, the originals. He still has the cutout of himself in the dojo in his living room. Which is always great when you in the middle of the night. But I think at that point I was like, oh, there's pictures of my dad and this. And then I, you know, as I got older, I put it together. It was never a strange thing for me. It was always like, oh, this is what my dad does. This is what, and I would visit him on movie sets, and I always enjoyed it. It was fun for me. And then obviously I fell into the same business, and you know, it's been great. So it was just kind of, it just unrolled naturally as I got older.
How did your career unnatural or naturally roll out, or did it, or was it unnatural? What was that like?
I would say it's all unnatural. The movie business is completely unnatural, if you know what I mean. But, you know, my dad never pushed me to be in the industry. Actually never wanted me to be in the industry, just because it, you know, it is such a roller coaster, you know, the highs and the lows. And, but I, when I was 18, I just wanted to do it professionally. And, you know, I was always in the theater arts programs in high school. And I, you know, I went into, you know, did film school, and I went to like the New York Film Academy for a summer. And it was just always part of, you know, what I wanted to do. And every time I was making movies or acting, it never felt like work to me. And so when I was 18, I set out and I got an agent, and I, you know, wanted to do it all on my own. And, you know, my dad didn't kind of like, you know, give me a leg up, you know, auditioned like everybody else. And it's been great ever since.
What was your first major role? What was your first paid role, if you can remember? Ooh,
that's good. First paid role. I think I was like background. I was probably 17. I was like background in a movie my dad did, where I shaved my head, and it was like just some soldier walking in the back. And it was exciting. It was fun. I was in high school. I remember that. And then I think one of those memorable ones for me when I was really young, I was 18, I think, I did this movie called Axe Giant. And it was all about Paul Bunyan, who was supposed to be this huge giant who terrorizes these kids who are like, you know, these misfits who are going on this camping trip because they're all juvenile delinquents. They end up stealing something from this cave, and Paul Bunyan goes after them, and I try to save the day and sacrifice myself. So that was a really fun one. You guys can check that out. It's a really good laugh.
You know what else is really good? I was watching Max Reload today.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's a fun movie. It's got a lot of great names in it. Yeah, it was better than I expected it was going to be. It's got Kevin Smith in it.
Isn't it great?
Yeah, and I think if Kevin Smith decides to do a cameo in a movie, it's got to be pretty good.
Hell yeah.
And there's a lot of throwbacks. There's a lot of 80s video games movie throwbacks in that movie as well.
Yes, Scott Condit and Jeremy Tremp, who directed that, they actually directed my dad and I in a short we did, which is on Amazon, which you should check out. You would love it. It's called Show No Mercy. My dad basically plays himself from Karate Kid. Like, and he's like basically run down. He owns a gaming bar, and then we both end up getting sucked into a video game, and we have to fight each other to get out. It's pretty cool. It's like 20 minutes.
You can find that on Amazon.
Yeah. But yeah, Max Reload is a great movie. Super happy about that project. Lynn Shay from Insidious movies are in there. Kevin Smith, Greg Grunberg from Star Wars and Star Trek. That just came out a couple of months ago. It's a great one.
Greg Grunberg is always fun to watch. I was actually really surprised to see him pop up in the Star Wars movies of late.
Oh, he's a huge nerd. Huge nerd. I laughed. All we did was talk like nerdy stuff on set. It was amazing.
I bet. Tell me about the movie you made with Joseph Fiennes, which I had read that it's an unofficial sequel to Chariots of Fire.
That's correct. Yeah. This was a Chinese-American co-production. I mean, the movie's like, you know, 90% English. And so we shot the movie in China, in Beijing, for about 3 months. Joe and I, you know, spent a lot of time together. We basically, it's just about these Americans, including, which is all truth to history. He ended up getting put into an internment camp. And what happens to him in this internment camp, which is what he did, was he started teaching school, and he was preaching, Christianity and helping a lot of the other POWs in the camp. He eventually, unfortunately, died in the camp, but, you know, they do a great, story about what happens with him inside, and I end up getting sick, and he ends up wanting to race the general of this camp to try and get medicine for me. And it's a beautiful movie, really beautiful movie, super well done. It's a huge, huge film, the biggest movie I've ever done. It's massive. We were there for a long time, so definitely check that out, On Wings of Eagles. It's a really great one.
Yeah, I watched some of the clips in the trailer, and it is like an epic movie. But I had no idea it was the unofficial sequel. I remember Chariots of Fire when I was a child. I'd never watched it, so I didn't even know. I knew they ran on the beach. That's the extent of my knowledge of that movie.
Is there running? A little bit of that. A little bit.
Do you end up running on the beach at all?
I'm not running on the beach. Joe and I basically ran together every day for like months because we had to lose a lot of weight when we were in the camps. So we basically did that, ate apples and almonds every day. But he basically has a sequence like that in the movie, which is very reminiscent of Chariots of Fire. It's a beautiful movie, and it was just an incredible experience. I mean, you know, we filmed it all over China, Tianjin, and We had the premiere in Cal. It was incredible.
So are you a fan of Karate Kid, or have you had enough of it by now?
I was literally wearing my Cobra Kai shirt today.
Were you? So yeah, talk about the time you spent on set. Your dad is obviously around. Did he make it to the set to see your scene?
He did. I actually worked it out. So I stayed with him because he was already shooting the show. I stayed with him while we were there. It just made more sense. And I wanted to, you know, visit him. And I had an earlier call than him that day. So I went to set, you know, I was ready to go. As I opened the van door where, Barrett Carnahan, who plays young Kreese, he and I met for the first time, which was really interesting because I'm chatting with him and I'm like, oh, so you're playing the younger version of my dad. And he was so honored. And it was really cool to see how much care he put into that character, which, and he was great. He and I become good friends. And so we opened the van and here are all these like 1960s cars at this amazing diner. It's huge. I mean, they got all these lights. It's a big day for this flashback sequence. And, you know, they got all the extras for the diner. And then we have the fight scene that happens later on. We've been rehearsing for that days before. And we're doing the scene, just as you saw, I walk in, we did that a few times. And then as I was sitting at the table, my dad walked in from the back, and I just kind of glance over at him, and he looks at me with this huge smile, and he sees me looking up at his younger character and tormenting him. And it was a surreal moment. I mean, definitely a beautiful moment for both of us as artists and as father and son, you know, to kind of see his son and for me as well, just join the original Karate Kid universe. Not the Cobra Kai universe, but the Karate Kid universe.
Yeah.
And be there, live that for this and help, you know, show his backstory, which was really incredible. And it was an honor to do that. And obviously, you know, being the bully of the biggest bully there is, or the misunderstood bully, it was very cool. And I was really grateful, really, really grateful. And I really wanted to make everybody proud, and it was fantastic.
Well, I thought it was pretty amazing that they did dive into Kreese's character and they waited 2 seasons to do that. This is episode 2 where it really starts. But there's an arc, and it's not just Kreese, the bully. You get to really know how he grew up and what made Kreese who he was today or who he is today, which is pretty amazing. So
it's,
I know
it's incredible. I think, I was just going to say a lot of people really wanted to know where he came from, how he started, and you know, hopefully they get into a little more of that in season 4, but you know, it was just nice to even touch upon that. I think it was a huge deal for people to see that, because you know, Ralph has some of his and you mm-hmm. know Ralph's backstory, and you see a bit of Johnny's in season 2, and then seeing Kreese's backstory, which is also nice because you kind of love him and hate him at the same time. You know, when you see me bully him, you kind of feel for him, you know.
Yeah.
And it's very interesting for the writers, who are incredible, John, Josh, and Hayden, to create that.
Yeah, I got a message from a friend here. Matt says, you seem like a super nice guy, but your character is such a dick. I mean, that goes to show how great of an actor you are, really.
Well, I appreciate that. I mean, bullies, being a bully or a bad guy runs the family, right?
What kind of character would you like to do you gravitate towards? Is it the bully? Is it the nice guy? Steve was a really nice guy in the Max Reload movie.
Well, I love 2 things. I love comedy. Comedy is just so comes naturally to me. I just love being funny. I love making people laugh. And are we allowed to curse on this, by the way? Are we allowed to?
Yeah.
We try
yeah,
to keep
good.
It. Okay. All right. I fucking love to play bad guys. It is literally my favorite thing, because there's so much freedom that you get when you get to play. Just like my dad would say the same thing. There's so much freedom that you get when you're playing a villain, because as a hero, you have to be in these certain parameters. You know, you can push the boundary a little bit, but as a villain or a bad guy, you really get to just go all the way if you want to, you know, say this or say that. And, you know, you can really touch upon certain specific things that you kind of keep in line with playing the good guy. So it's, you know, it can be tough as well at the same time, but it's also, it's just really fun. It's also fun to play someone that you're not, you know?
Yeah. Well, that's what acting is, really.
Yeah, exactly.
Everybody loves Johnny. Johnny is the bad boy. He always was in all the 80s movies. William Zabka played a lot of bad guys, and people loved his characters. So I think you're onto something. People just really enjoy that.
The nicest guy. He and I are good friends, you know, through my dad. And he is just the nicest guy, and an amazing father and family man.
Well, that's what I've heard about the whole cast and crew of the Karate Kid, the original. Everyone stayed pretty close. Everyone stayed very friendly, which is probably the reason why Cobra Kai all three seasons have been so successful because you have everybody wanting to come back. They did. I don't want to give too much away. They did the whole Japan episode, which was amazing.
So emotional, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And how it tied into the second one is amazing. But talk about growing up with those guys. Talk about seeing those guys on occasion and becoming friends with
Yeah, I mean, it's well, thanks. It's really, I mean, they're, you know, I've been around these guys for, you know, 20 years. It's been, you know, Ralph lives in New York, so, you know, I see him obviously less, but every time there's a press junket, I've gone on these different comic cons with these guys. You know, it's amazing. You know, these, my dad, Billy and Ralph, they care so much about these characters and the legacy of these characters. You know, it's not like they just want to, you know, sell them out. You know, they really, they want to know where these characters, you know, what the emotions of these characters, you know, where are they going to go, the arc of their lives, you know, and how they've changed over the years and where they're at now. You know, like Ralph dealing with these familial problems like most men deal when they have a family. You know, it's not just the Karate Kid dealing with these issues. It's his character, you know, Daniel's father. And same thing with my dad. Where is he going to go? What are all these things that are going to happen? You know, he talked about in this other interview with, I think it was Entertainment Weekly, we were on together. He talked about maybe he's got a love interest that might come into his life. Maybe it's someone who's going to whip him in shape. Who knows? And of course,
I don't know. Go back. What do you think about your dad becoming? Because we found out that Billy became, you know, a nice guy. He's misunderstood. Right. He's not the bad boy that he was back then. He's a great guy. Could you see that with Kreese? Could we do that with Kreese? Or would that just take everything over the top?
I mean, I think there's got to be there's a little bit of good and there's a little bit of bad. I mean, I don't think he'll ever fully give up on his hard knocks ways. But I think, you know, and like my dad always says, he's just a little misunderstood. That's all. Just like you saw in the flashback sequence with me. You know, everybody's got a past and everybody's got a story. So where does his start? And we see a little bit of that. And, you know, I think you start to feel for him a little bit more. But I think it'd be great. I mean, I'd love to see some of these other sides of Kreese, you know, that we haven't seen before.
It was tough for him. There's a lot of things that come out that made him who he is, and it really wasn't his fault. Let's talk about you more.
Okay.
So talk about coronavirus the last year, how it's been on your career. What you have been able to work on, what you're planning on working on. Have you just been laying low for a year?
I've been really fortunate. I've worked a lot throughout COVID. I've done three movies since COVID started, which has been really great. Another one, a Christmas movie that just came out a couple weeks ago on Lifetime, and another Lifetime thriller that'll be out. And then I had Max Reload come out, and then I had a Cobra Kai come out. I've also got another movie coming out in a week or so, Bring Me a Dream, that I did in Atlanta, another thriller. So it's been really, you know, as unfortunate it's been for a lot of people, I've been very fortunate, but it's also been, you know, hard at the same time, you know, having to, you know, deal with, you know, like the quarantines that are happening. And also when I filmed my movie during COVID, it was a very interesting experience. I the first time doing a movie with COVID and, you know, with the masks and having nurses come to the set every day, test you, and the social distancing aspect of it, because, you know, as an actor, you need to be social with the people you're working with. And, you know, I had to get used to that and the regulations around that. And, you know, it was really the set I was working on, Christmas on the Menu, is called. You know, everybody was great. The crew was so grateful to be working at the time because things were shut down for so long and the industry had no idea what the hell to do. They finally figured it out a bit. And so I think, you know, it's opening up more and more as we go. You know, a lot of productions are opening up again, which is great. And it's just been interesting. You know, it's been sad as well, you know, for a lot of people around the country. I feel my heart really goes out to a lot of people that it's affected in a really horrible way. People have lost their businesses and their livelihoods. I mean, it's just terrible. It's terrible what's been going on. You know, part of me feels like, you know, the artistic aspect of what we do kind of helps people, you know, maybe get away from the realities of life for a brief moment of time, you know, maybe inspire them in some way. So, yeah, that's my two cents.
I've always used movies, TV as an escape, and I think it's an amazing industry. I really do. And it's been, well, I don't want to say it's been sad, over the last year that the industry has kind of slowed down because there's still a lot of independent movies that are being pumped out, like a lot of the movies that you're making. So right. I think being part of a smaller set and a smaller crew and smaller budget, I mean, I've seen many independent movies that's far surpass any big budget movie just based on story and character. Yep. So I enjoy digging deep into Amazon and finding these independent movies. And then, you know, but it's very frustrating at the same time that, you know, Ghostbusters still hasn't come out and we got to wait until Top Gun till the summer. Right.
Yeah. So they're waiting for the right moment. You know, they're waiting for the right moment. I would agree with how they're doing. I mean, you know, look, Wonder Woman that was released on HBO. I watched it. It was great. I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was fun. I think, you know, they're testing the waters out and seeing, you know, how many people are going to watch it at home. But I think, you know, I'm obviously a big fan of movies being in theaters. You know, Christopher Nolan had a huge battle with the studios because he didn't like they're releasing all these movies on streaming services. And, you know, I agree with them and I disagree with them at the same time, because I also want movies to be in the theater, because going to the movie theater for me is a magical experience. I don't want people to forget that, you know?
Unfortunately, we might be in that position, but yeah, you're right. I mean, to go see the latest Batman movie on the big screen it's an event and it's something I shared with my kids. At the same time, it is nice being in your living room. We have a decent sized TV. You can pause. Hey, you got a kitty behind you. Look behind you. You got a kitty. What's a kitty's name?
This is Aura.
Aura.
Sweet little Aura. Yeah, she's a good girl.
I have two kitties at home. I had a black cat for a while, but
she can stay. She'll stay.
There you go. We've got two kitties and we just got a bunny the other day.
Oh my God. I had a bunny once. They're so sweet.
I fought it for so long, but I have a 10-year-old daughter with the eyes and everything. So we now have a bunny as well.
Man, I'm like this horrible bully. And here I am with my, with my damn cat. Like, I'm just the worst. All right. I'm just horrible.
You're so bad. You're the guy that created Kreese. You could be responsible. Well, Jesse,
I need to like this.
Yeah. Jesse, tell us what we should be watching. Give me some plugs for some of your movies.
Definitely watch Christmas on the Menu that just came out. Obviously, Max Reload and the Nether Blasters. Cobra Kai, of course. And then Bring Me a Dream, which is a thriller that's coming out this next week or two, directed by Chase Smith. You like that? My dad's actually got a fun little cameo in that. It's really cool. There's some flashback sequences with him, my dad, in that movie, which is fun. We love working together, my dad and I. And also Recipe for Abduction, that'll be on Lifetime as well. So there's a lot of good stuff in the can. And you know, obviously people can reach out to me on social media, Twitter and Instagram at Jesse Kove. Of course, I'm always watching and I love talking to fans and stuff.
Is it exciting being part of the Lifetime family now? Because they are churning out a lot of movies. They put a lot into their entertainment.
They really do. Oh, it's great. I love working. I work hard, you know, and I'm willing to put the blood, sweat, tears into my work. So I enjoy it.
I watched VFW. One last thing. I watched VFW the other day. And I didn't see
I
couldn't find
about that. I'm one of the hypers. I'm kind of coming in there quickly, but I'm one of the guys. I'm actually Stephen Lang. I'm the first guy he kills. He puts an axe into my chest.
Oh, okay. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. What a great movie that was.
Oh, it was incredible. You know, it's funny. When my dad first read the script for that, he goes, man, he's like, this is a bloody movie. I don't know if I should do this. I said, Dad, you got to do this movie. It's so good. The script is amazing. I was like, he's like, but it's so dark and bloody. He's like, yeah, but people are going to love seeing you kick ass on screen. And then, you know, we did it. And then, you know, obviously he and Stephen Lang became great friends. And William Sadler. I mean, it was so funny because all these guys, I was hanging out on set with them all day. These guys between all of them had like 700 movies between like the five of these guys. So all day it was like watching them just, you know, banter back and forth. I'm working with this actor and this director and this movie. It was like a history lesson. It was incredible.
Fred Williamson is in it as well. Yeah. And George Wendt has a moment in the movie. Yes. And who am I missing? Am I missing anybody else? Oh, the guy from the Warriors. I always forget his name.
Oh, the little
guy.
Yeah.
Warriors here, come out and play.
DVD right over here.
You know who I'm talking about.
Yes.
Warriors come out and play. Yay. So all these guys are around the same age. They've been, like you said, you know, 700 movies collectively. What an actor's dream to be around that. And I love Stephen Lang. Ever since The Hard Way with Michael J. Fox, I've always been a fan of Stephen Lang.
So good. Such a thespian actor as well. He's really in love with theater. He's great. He's fantastic.
Fun action slash horror movie. And look for the axe in Jesse's chest. That's Jesse.
That's a good one.
Hey, it was great talking to you, Jesse. I appreciate it.
Oh, thank you guys so much. Thanks for having me. I hope to talk to you soon.
Absolutely. Take care.
All right. You too.